Do you want to know about social injustice in Scottish history? Let me tell you a story. Now, as I do, if you're interested in the people, places and events in Scottish history, then click the subscribe button in the bottom right-hand side of the screen at any time. In the meantime, let me tell you my story. Now, civil strife and social injustice happen in lots of places. But it's the 29th of August, and from one of the two main locations of the events in our story, I want to take you back to Tranent, East Lothian in 1797. The union between Scotland and England happened 90 years ago. After hundreds of years of fighting with our southern neighbours, the good thing about the union was that finally wars had stopped. I mean, there were the Jacobite wars of the first half of the century. And of course, we've been dragged into England's wars. The War of the Spanish Succession, the War of the Austrian Succession, there have been some wars in India, the Seven Years' War, the Mysore War in India, the Anglo-Maratha War in India. Oh, there was that rebellion in the Americas. They all come to a sticky end. And of course, now we're at war with France. But apart from that, it's been pretty peaceful. Now, the thing about all these English wars is that now they've become our wars too. We've been incorporated in the English army. Well, almost. You see, in 1757, they introduced the Militia Act. That meant the creation of military reserves locally in each county. Now, these reserves would provide backup on the home front so that regular army could be sent abroad. But the requirement only applied in England and Wales. Here in Scotland, we just continued as we were, with volunteer units here and there, normally organised by nobility or clan chiefs. You know, up in the Highlands where they talk Irish and that. Then, 3 years ago, a royal warrant created Lord Lieutenants in each county. Here is the Marquess of Tweedale, but he had deputies, and one of them, David Anderson, lived in this house, St Germain. I know, it sounds French, and I get the irony. The house is split into seven now, and I've been welcomed here by the owners of the St Germain Bed and Breakfast. So the lieutenants had to organise volunteer forces to protect the counties in case of invasion by the French. The French, who up until this union thing, had protected us against the English. Or did we protect them? I'm not sure. Anyway, now this year they've passed the Militia Act for Scotland, and these Lord Lieutenants are required to raise militias in every county. Not volunteers, they draw lots in a ballot to decide who will be forced to join the militia. So, the country is in uproar. Not just here in Tranent, but everywhere. And it's not just that folk are sick of their sons going off to war. Being forced into the militia means that you can be sent anywhere in the country as part of the home defence. Now, what if you've got a harvest to get in? What if you've got a business to run? What if they do send you off to some foreign land? Now, I know they say that you won't serve abroad, but they said that to the Black Watch, and look what happened to them. That's another story for another video. The point is that you can't trust the London government not to send you off to some foreign war for which you didn't sign up and to which they promised not to send you. There's one more reason that folks are furious about the Militia Act, but I'm going to save that until later. Aye. Your eyes will pop out of your head when you hear it, and I don't want you to miss the story. So it's August 1797. There's civil unrest all over because of the Militia Act and these Lord Lieutenants with a list of names and their roulette wheels. On the 29th of August, the Deputy Lieutenants tasked with raising the militia in this area were to meet in the Glens Inn in Tranent to draw the lottery. And of course, to consider any exemptions. You see, you could be exempted for service if you had a justifiable excuse. Let's say you had bone spurs, for example. I'll be honest, I don't know what bone spurs are. I just know that it gets you out of enlistment. But if you were a boxer, a fit and healthy black boxer, you might even be the greatest boxer. You couldn't get out of it then. Anyway, they're ludicrous examples and it's all fantasy and imagining. The point is that there was a big meeting to take place in Tranent on the 29th of August. So let's go there for a bit. This is Tranent Town Centre and this is Jackie Crookston. She's banging a drum and she's got a wee bairn. You see, the night before the meeting, she went up and down the streets of Tranent leading hordes of women and their bairns shouting, "We'll have no militia here," to anyone that would listen. These women also went around the surrounding towns and villages banging that drum and telling folks to come to Tranent tomorrow to air their grievances and let the authorities know there would be no militia here. And whilst this mob of women was going around surrounding villages, back here in Tranent, somebody threw stones at a dragoon. In different towns and villages, teachers faced varying levels of harassment. You see, teachers had the lists of the able-bodied men that had been through the school system as boys, and it was these lists that were used for balloting the militia. Some teachers were accosted and had their lists stolen so they couldn't be used the next day. Others had no problems. By the morning, the teachers' complaints had arrived back here at St Germain, the house of the Deputy Lieutenant David Anderson. Realising that folk were upset, the gentlemen lieutenants headed to Tranent accompanied by yeomanry and cavalry, and they sent to Musselburgh for further reinforcements. When they got to Tranent, Jackie was still banging on about no militia. See what I did? The officials arrived at the Glen's Inn around midday. Now, after a bit of shouting and Jackie Crookston's drum banging, the business of the day was announced to the crowd, and the lieutenants and teachers, etc., went in to get started with weeding out the exemptions and drawing lots. One by one, district by district, individuals came in to offer up their evidence of why they should be exempted. Now, obviously, the crowd outside is still restive, but in spite of their complaints, the process goes on. Then, in comes a potter called Neil Cootershide. What he places on the table isn't a justification for his own exclusion from the list, but a document signed by the townspeople opposing the Militia Act. Obviously, the chairman rejects this document out of hand, and Cootershide's sent away with a flea in his ear. Is that just a Scottish expression, to be sent away with a flea in your ear? I don't know. Anyway, when Cootershide related the events indoors to the crowd outside, then the women retreat to the back and the men move forward. "Whoa," says Captain Finlay of the Cinqports Cavalry, and he sends his troopers forward. A woman throws a stone and knocks a trooper's hat off. Now that must have felt brilliant. But as the trooper gets down from his horse to get his hat, the trooper somehow falls. Captain Finlay orders his men to unsheath their swords, and oh my God, they charge, trampling and slashing the populace. The mob start throwing more stones and all hell breaks loose. Inside, one of the officials tries to read the Riot Act. Now, I don't know if you know what I mean by reading the Riot Act. Can you let me know in the comments section below? And if people don't know about this particular part of British history, then I'll cover it in a different video. Anyway, outside, the cavalry troops, who are apparently a bit sozzed, they're going up and down the street charging and slashing. This sends people up the alleyways, and on the roof of one building, a guy called William Hunter starts throwing down stones and bricks at the troops. One soldier is sent round the back of the house to shoot him from behind. And as he tumbles from the roof, several other soldiers wait for his fallen body with outstretched weapons, so that as he topples from the roof, he's impaled on their swords. Now, this is the first, but not the last, gruesome act of the day. Pembrokeshire cavalry turn up. Now, if there was any doubt about the previous troops, these guys are definitely pissed. So much so that one sergeant slumps sozzled from his saddle. An officer, thinking he's been knocked off his horse, calls, "Why don't you fire?" They do. George Elder was shot dead with the first volley of bullets. The events are known as the Tranent Massacre. Now, I don't know how many you need in dead and injured to call it a massacre. What I do know is that the troops, who let's remember were essentially in a recruitment drive, didn't limit themselves to those who'd been involved in the rioting. The drunken troops were given the order to clear the county for 2 miles around. The 29th of August is after the glorious 12th, and the troops acted like they were shooting game. It started in the town. 19-year-old Isabel Roger, who'd been sewing cloth in the doorway of her house, was shot dead. William Lawson was a carpenter taking wood in his cart from Ormiston to Tranent. When he was accosted by troops, he explained that he'd never been near the riot, but they shot him anyway. Stephen Brotherson, along with his wife and an old man, were out for a walk about a mile from Tranent. As the troops arrived, the walkers stepped off the road to let them pass. It wasn't enough to shoot the innocent Brotherson. As he lay dying in his wife's arms, the dragoon then got down from his horse, drew his sword, and slashed 6 times at his head and body, cutting through to the bone. The same troops continued on and shot dead William Laidlaw, a peasant labouring in the field. A 13-year-old boy called Kemp, who carried letters between Tranent and Ormiston, was chased down like an animal and stabbed and hacked to death in a field. Peter Ness, a sawmill worker, hadn't been in Tranent, but in a field outside the town he was shot multiple times, then robbed of his pocket watch. After he was killed, he was found dead with his pockets turned inside out. But there was more pillage than that. John Adam, a collier who lived in a village a couple of miles from Tranent, was walking to the shops to do a few errands. Dragoons approached him, shot him in the head, and as he lay dying, took from his pocket the 2 shillings that he'd carried to buy messages for his pregnant wife. At the start of this, I was going to name each victim to remember them. But to be honest, it's too harrowing even now. The soldiers also burst into a farmhouse and shot up a family that didn't even know there was a riot going on. Deputy lieutenants in charge in the day sued the Scots Chronicle for libel because they published a letter relating to one of the deaths. The even greater sadness is that without the evidence accumulated for that civil suit, we may never have known the names of these victims. Remember that the whole exercise was to recruit people into the very organisation that was currently slaughtering innocents and protesters alike in the streets of Tranent and surrounding countryside. As recruiting drives go, this wasn't the most successful. They were finding bodies in cornfields for weeks. And it was another 11 years before a militia was finally established for that county. Now, I said that I had one big point that I was going to leave to the end, and I'm coming to that. But just before I do, let me tell you about the court case. On the day, 36 townspeople were taken as prisoners to Haddington and then later to Edinburgh for trial. But the only witnesses against them were the soldiers, who all gave contradictory evidence, and all the accused were released. Maybe I should have said all the survivors, because of course Jackie Crookston with the big drum had been shot dead in the street. This isn't the only time that there's been injustice and civil unrest in Scotland. In fact, at the end I've got a playlist that you can click for some other examples of unrest in Scottish society. But the thing is that none of this needed to happen. You see, the Militia Act stated that if you were selected by ballot from the list, you didn't have to join the militia. All you needed was to have enough money to pay somebody else to join a militia in your place. And that's the information I left till now. It was only the poor who had to join a militia. That's what the miners, potters, weavers and farm folk of Tranent were up in arms about. That's what the innocent dead of the 29th of August 1797 signify. And that's the searing social injustice that this video highlights. How much have things changed? You'll have to decide that for yourself. But share the story. Hamian Dock is going to be a llama alive. Cheery and drastic.